Vergecast at CES 2014, day zero, Monday, whatever you want to say. I'm Josh Topolsky.
I'm Nilay Patel.
I'm Vlad Savov.
We have a Vlad with us today.
There's a Vlad sighting.
A rare creature from the mountains of Bulgaria.
How are you?
I'm actually from the flatlands.
The flatlands of Bulgaria. But nonetheless,
what is the
rare
difference between the mountainous and flatland Bulgarian?
I think that kind of goes without saying, isn't it?
Well, actually,
the elevation?
Elevation, cuisine.
Everybody knows the flatlanders in Bulgaria far classier than the highlanders.
Actually, we love each other. I mean, we have a very good relationship.
All right. Anyhow, we're at CES.
And now that this racism is over.
we're at CES. The show has not officially started yet, but this is
so. This is a lie. I don't know why we keep telling this lie.
Well, it hasn't.
Yeah, but like
but the real show, the real
CES just needs to stop lying to us. Like
and
this
CES
is the first
is
day.
Lie. I'm not going to be held accountable for their lie.
I'm just saying, it's a lie.
Well, yeah, but technically speaking, you go around all the booths and there's all this infrastructure going on. There's like cranes and whatnot.
Right.
So
the actual show starts tomorrow.
Right.
And today, it's basically all the companies announcing their products because tomorrow, when the floor opens, they want people to go to see the new stuff that they made.
And play with it. Yep.
And play with it. Right. So, anyhow, but we've had a crazy, insane
today has been a very strange day.
It's been a strange day. It's had its ups and downs. It is, it's not over. Right now, we have Intel live blog happening. There's probably news breaking at this moment.
Yeah.
And then we also have an Audi event tonight at
Audi event actually is going to be very interesting because late last night, Google issued a press release saying they're doing Android in cars. GM is a partner. Audi's a partner.
Open Automotive Alliance?
Yes.
Just like their great
just
open handset
a miserable
alliance,
name.
Which everybody loves. And
yeah, everyone remembers how well that went. Right? No. Android isn't fragmented at all. Really?
Don't get me started on the Note 3. Go ahead.
Well, it's just crazy. so the big rumor is that Audi's going to have some like Google integration, some Google Glass, Google Now kind of stuff going on in the car.
Right.
So that's going to be a big one.
Yeah.
I will say that the Google, the Open Automotive Alliance, a terrible name in reference to a failed idea, and just literally hours after GM announced a proprietary app store for their proprietary OS in the Corvette.
It's very confusing. It feels like a real half step, which is not uncommon for Google to do. Like, oh, like we'll throw it out there. We'll have an alliance. Maybe something will happen.
It's a great sort
maybe
of.
It won't.
I mean, if you're Google, it's a great press release to issue sort of at night as CES winds down because everyone gets all excited. Android on cars.
Right.
And has anybody ever tried to put anything in a car? Like, cars are some of the least standardized things in the world. And to think that automotive manufacturers are going to come together and standardize in an OS interface is just insane.
Yeah, like if you try to get a new stereo, a unit for your car,
you have to go to some
there's like a list, there's like a spreadsheet of figuring out what kind of adapter you have. And like even for model years, they're like, you know, you go a couple of years and there's a difference between.
Literally, the only thing I can think of in cars that's standardized is like the cigarette socket. And I'm assuming that like big tobacco
wheels,
had to like
tires.
No, those are totally not. You can't take
rims.
Cars off rims off a car and put them on another car.
Oh, I don't know that. I didn't know that because I'm not a rim. I'm not a rim guy.
Yeah. Well, who isn't?
Okay, I'm going to move on from that.
I consider that their way of differentiating. It's exactly the same way with hardware manufacturers with Android smartphones.
Yeah.
Right.
I guess so.
They actually do worse software than the stock Android software just to be different and just to differentiate.
You're talking about the software in cars?
Yeah, and I'm saying
don't even get me started
phones,
on the software.
But the car manufacturers are just no different from hardware manufacturers.
Have you seen the software that the car manufacturers put in their cars? Like, if you think Android fragmentation and skinning on phones is bad, just wait until like I don't know, like any major car company does stuff to.
Yeah, but even people who I don't think are very good at UI like Samsung or LG, I think them doing something, not that they're going to be doing it, but something like that in a car would be, it's kind of like, they're kind of like cable boxes.
Yeah.
They're so bad that almost anything that's more current would be an improvement over what they're, let's put it this way. My bad Panasonic, like 2-year-old Panasonic smart TV interface is preferable to my Time Warner cable box.
Yeah.
In terms of like getting around.
And all of that is preferable to like what's in your car.
Yes, all of that. I would rather use my cable box than the stereo in my car.
Yeah.
Which is crazy.
And so let's give them Android and see what happens. Like, that's what I mean by the Open Handset Alliance was like, here's an industry body. And like for some parts of the industry, it works, right? For like chip makers.
Yeah.
They get Android builds early. They optimize them. They ship them off to manufacturers. And manufacturers are like, we have bad software designers. Let's do stuff to Android. Like just imagine how that's going to work with car makers.
It's
like,
not going to be good. But anyhow, but the thing is, there hasn't really even been news yet.
Right.
It's just that like Google's it's like, hey, we're bringing these, exciting. We're going to have these companies participate in this open auto alliance or whatever. So the Audi event tonight could be the first place that we see some.
And that's exciting because they're doing all this. There's a lot of like robot car, self-driving car stuff happening here.
Yeah.
And that's interesting.
It's nice, but it's future tech. It's like 10 years from now.
I get the sense that self-driving car is a lot closer than people think. That's just my...
You know, but this is the guy. You're the guy who's like, 4K is going to happen. And it's
I can actually, 4K is this like, year I can like prove it to you.
I think.
I've now been to.
We already had this conversation on the 3 o'clock show, but I think 4K, really widespread 4K adoption is like a decade away.
I think one of.
I'm now today, more convinced than ever.
After today, I think one of the biggest stories.
Oh, really?
No, I think it's like 2 years away, and I think one of the biggest stories of the show.
You are smoking that, very good weed.
No, I think one of the biggest stories of the show is the fact that Netflix is more poised than ever to completely dominate, like, how we make and distribute television.
Well, there's no question that Netflix is in a killer position.
Reed Hastings, he's basically sprinting from press event to press event to walk on stage and be like, he has the same basic thing that he's saying everywhere. He's like, you know, we demoed Netflix to the executives of any company here several years ago, and they laughed at us and said, get better, and then we got better, and now we're here, and it's like... And then they begged me to make 4K, and then I waited.
But here's the thing.
And he's like, and now we're shooting House of Cards in 4K. And they're like, everyone's so happy about it.
Like, that's cool. Shoot it in 4K. Make it available on Netflix in 4K. There are no TVs, and there's no bandwidth.
So the bandwidth, they've gotten really close to the bandwidth.
Oh, we'll have to see.
No, this is super nerdy, but all of these companies this year, the TVs, have hardware decoders for H.265. Which is the next one.
Right.
And they can do 4K in like 15 megabits a second. That's what Sony just announced. Vizio told me the same thing last night. Every TV, like, there's this like set
that's
of component
the TVs,
upgrades.
The TVs released this year, which means really 50% of the TVs released this year, or less than. I'll bet it's like 20% of the TVs released
but
this year will
this
have
way.
H.265 decoders.
I just bought a new TV. Every TV that you can buy.
Is it 4K?
No. Cyber Monday, man. But it has 3D, right? And I was like, well, it came with glasses, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, I have a 3D TV. Like, I'm going to put on the glasses and try to find something to watch. I couldn't do it. Like, it's not available to watch.
Yeah.
With 4K, you're going to buy this stuff. And if you have Netflix, which most people buying 4K TVs at this moment in time have, they're going to have great things to watch immediately. Because Netflix is committed
to
that.
But you're talking about the new buyer starting in 2014, and we're talking about probably like...
I'm saying mainstream adoption like easily now within 5 years. Like the TV that you buy in the store...
I mean, I think 5 is not unrealistic, but I think that you're really not going to see the kind of penetration that HD has for another decade.
Right, but on that point about what does actually mainstream penetration and adoption mean? Because it's always gradual. Even with HD, which has been around for such a long time, and we consider it adopted to that degree, there are still really mainstream channels that don't.
I'm talking about consumer. Consumer
like,
purchase of.
But when you say
television.
HD, like Fox broadcasts in 720p.
That's CBS actually the point. That's the point that I made earlier, which is like the networks are still a lot of them are still shooting in.
Never ever Google 1080p penetration with Save Your Job.
What? Come on.
Just do not do that.
No, the networks are still doing shows in 720. But here's what I'll say. So just imagine the industry, and I said this earlier, but I'll repeat it.
Wow.
Newsrooms, you need 4K gear to do your show.
Oh God, page two gets worse.
Soap operas, you need 4K gear to do all your shows. Dramas, you need 4K gear. I mean, they are starting to shoot. I mean, a lot of people shoot on Red. There's other standards out there.
Vizio is shooting they shot the Rose Bowl. They hired Rez shoot the Rose Bowl
in
4K.
I know it's possible. What I'm saying is you have to completely redo the infrastructure of the shows and in the homes. But here's the thing.
Well, you don't have to redo the infrastructure. You just have to get a new TV in the home.
You have to get a new TV and you have to get new gear to shoot on. Because most people
But the gear, they're already
the networks are shooting on 720.
Yeah, but that's like
But the biggest networks in America are shooting on 720. In 720.
Right. So the next jump they're going to make, they never upgrade to 1080.
Sure, they won't go to 1080, they'll go to 4K.
But Fox is already, do you see the thing David did about the NFL on Fox?
Yeah.
They're already using 4K cameras all over the place.
I understand that the people are shooting it, okay? I know that it's out there. What I'm saying is, you have networks, lots of them, the vast majority, they haven't even gone full HD. They're doing 720. They're probably never, they'll probably never do it. They probably will jump to 4K. But like, think about how long it took. Now, I mean, we just got to a point where it's saturated here, where there's like basically the entire market is. But there are still some channels that don't do HD broadcast. There's plenty of channels that don't do HD broadcast in America. And we've just gotten to the point where it's really saturated. So everybody just got their HD TV.
But this is why I'm saying I think Netflix is like the story of the show, right? Like,
yeah. So I think for early adopters, you're right.
You know, LG had Netflix on stage. I believe Samsung had Netflix on stage. I think Sony had Netflix on stage. Like, when you talk about the companies that are like making the future of TV and like doing interesting things on TV, yes, the networks have all the, you know, like A&E has Mad Men, right? But Netflix does have House of Cards. They do have Orange is the New Black. And they announced tonight at the Sony event, everything they make from now on is going to be 4K.
No, I get that people are making it.
But that content vault of like, it's not just one movie, it's not just Oblivion that you can get on Sony. It takes 50 hours to download.
Right.
It's 60 hours of TV.
No, I think Netflix is going to be first in because they are on the cutting edge of delivery, right? That's the easiest part for them.
But the thing that enabled that, like there's like a weird... This is super nerdy, and I have no idea if we should do this story.
Just do it.
But there's a weird confluence of like all the components like made it this year. So last year they were showing like panels, right? Like here's a panel with all these pixels on it, and there's nothing to show on it. This year they're like behind the panel, there's HDMI 2.0 that has like better security for all these streaming services.
Oh, right.
There's like hardware code.
Better handshake problems.
Yeah, exactly. But no, and then there's better, like there's these hardware decoders, the next gen codecs that enable them to bring the broadband requirement down. And there's just down the line, all these like components are better and cheaper.
Right, I know, and I totally get that. But what I'm saying is, everybody, like TV just got really good in the last 5 years. Like people were like, whoa, TV can be amazing, right? And everybody just got their HD sets and they're like, oh my God, HD is a thing
now. I
don't
think everybody just
got their
HD sets.
If you go back 5 years ago,
five generations.
I'd like to know, but I'll bet you 5 years ago, the adoption of HD sets in America was probably 50% or something. It probably was not even close to being the majority.
Well, I don't know. Every time I try to Google
it. Yeah, don't. How about HD TV ownership per capita or something, or by year?
No matter what you Google, it ends up in porn.
It took a decade of America saying we were going to do HD to it becoming being saturated.
Right, it's going to be gradual, but at the same time,
we're still not at 100.
I think
we're not at 100.
February 8th is 75%.
Okay, there you go. I
think the thing that both of you guys are missing out in your discussion of 5 years or 10 years or how many years it's going to take for 4K to become the standard is the fact that you actually totally agree on the fact that this is going to be the next standard.
Well, I mean, unless somebody decides that 8K is the next place.
It's kind of
BS that like 8K is going to come along 2 years after 4K becomes a thing.
This is what I'm saying about this like weird little component story that's happening in the background here. Like all of these standards that have been in flux, like kind of just got locked down, right? I mean, people have been telling me this now for 2 days.
But Sony and Samsung don't agree on delivery.
Yeah, they do.
They do now?
That's what I'm saying. Like, they've all settled on H.265, which they're calling HEVC. Like, super nerdy components.
Right.
Like,
okay, so H.265 is in play, but... All right, I'm saying is we are agreeing, essentially, that 4K is going to be... I mean, I don't think we're going to jump to 8K, because that's not how this industry works. It's going to do the... It's going to go, like... to the 4K level, and then they'll have something new to sell, which
will be... God, the watch story here is so stupid.
Which will be 8K.
Sorry.
But to your point, I mean, you were talking about it being gradual and still not being, and like you said, like, a lot of people haven't gone to full HD, but they're still doing 720. I think that to think about people just getting HD as a thing, to imagine those consumers going out and investing in something where the differences are... They're definitely noticeable to us. I think to an average consumer, I think the difference between full HD and 4K is a much tougher sell. Well, like, I just don't think they see...
It's about the size of the TV, actually.
Because it might be,
if you're looking at like 65 to 85 inches, again, we're not really talking about mainstream consumers. That range...
Well, we're not. We're talking about
60 is, I think, becoming the most popular size.
Right. Well... I guess in the U.S. that's
But I was going to say, but what's interesting is because, you know, in Europe and in Asia, people are living in smaller homes or in apartments. They live in very congested cities, but the suburban lifestyle has been like, basically, is kind of crumbling in America. I mean, people have been like, hey, we expanded out to the suburbs, and it turns out that's really terrible and hard to do a bunch of things, and people are starting to migrate back to. If you want to get like deep on some like the socioeconomics of what's happening in the world, people are actually starting to gravitate more towards crowded cities in America than they are being out in the cut. And so like when you start thinking about that, to Vlad's point, I do think you have a problem if like the selling point is big ass TVs. Like I have a 42-inch, we have a very small living room, it's only 12 feet wide. Anything bigger than like 55, mm-hmm. like I couldn't even put 55 where I would want to put it. Like at this point I'd have to like take some shelving out of the room. But anything bigger than that would be too big for my living room. And so if people do, if we look at the next decade and people do continue to gravitate towards cities.
Yeah, I mean, that's going to happen in like a small
way. And their McMansions continue to crumble in the suburbs, which is what I think is going to be happening.
Giant TVs left to rot.
As the polar ice cap melts and water levels rise, people move inland towards cities.
I mean, these companies are selling giant televisions.
They can like, sell. They can try to sell them, but when everybody's living, when everybody's living in Manhattan, they're going to have to sell 45-inch 720p.
Well, how old is your TV?
The one in my living room is 3 years old, and the one in my bedroom is like 2 years old, and I have no immediate plans to upgrade.
Right. Well, because they're just screens, right?
Yeah. But, I'm an early adopter.
Right.
I'm like one of
they're fundamentally just screens for you. Like, there's no added benefit. Like, your Roku isn't going to start looking better on a slightly better screen. Like, you can't pay money to get more out of a TV.
If Netflix was like, we offer all of our shows, everything now, the whole catalog, everything that's available on Netflix is now available in 4K.
Right.
Would not move the needle for me in any way. I just don't have, you know what would move the needle is like.
Oh, see, I would immediately like run out.
Here's what would move the needle.
Yeah.
Time Warner is like, you never have to worry about your bandwidth degrading or being throttled.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can, that might be like, oh, okay, if I don't have to contend with Time Warner's garbage service where it fluctuates between, like I pay for 50, but a lot of times it's 10.
Yeah.
Like if I don't have to pay for that and worry about like troubleshooting my router, and then 4K content's being offered, and they are like, "Hey, you only need really 15.
Vlad, you're not drinking this.
You only really need 15 to get the 4K content, and it's going to look not artifacted."
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay, maybe I begin to consider the thing, but we don't have that.
The solution exists.
Yeah, if you live in Korea.
Well, I was going to say the Netherlands, but yeah.
You're the people who make Samsung TVs
I know, and in Korea, just like in Japan and Europe, just like in Asia and Europe, they had HD for 10 years before it came to America.
Right.
I mean, they were doing
HD. Wait, are you kidding?
No.
It's the other way around.
No, it's not.
We did HD way first. There's still all kinds of places in Europe that don't have HD.
Yeah, forget about Europe. Okay, Europe, but in Asia, I mean, I remember going to Japan in like 2001, and it was just like HD. It was all over the place. Widescreen televisions were all over the place. HD was all over the place. And I was like, this is insane. What's happening? And it took forever. It took another 10 years for it to really become a thing.
Those places are weird. They're weird comparisons because there's so much.
You're here first. Nilay thinks Japan's weird.
It's so much smaller than America.
Yes,
right?
And like, yes.
Like, let's rebuild all the infrastructure of Japan. It's like let's rebuild.
I agree. That's why they're swiping their phones to get on. That's why they're swiping their phones to get on the subway and taking bullet trains all over the place. Like, but their infrastructure is like, they have their shit together. We do not.
But you know, Josh, you say something like, you know, if all of Netflix is available in 4K, it won't move the needle for you, but. You don't actually need like a really coherent or excellent argument for why you would want 4K. For a lot of people, it's really just one thing. So for sports fans, NFL fans, if the NFL decides to just switch to 4K and then the TVs become available, and honestly, the jump between last year where everybody was saying, we have 4K TVs, we'll let you know about pricing and availability later.
Yeah.
Wait.
And now where they're saying we have whole lines of 4K TVs.
Guys, I need to interrupt everything.
Yes?
We have breaking news.
What is it?
Intel has unveiled its own digital assistant called Jarvis that wraps around your head, wraps around your ear, and pairs with a smartphone, and then remotely interacts with you, which is insane.
Wait, isn't Jarvis the name of the...
The one from
Iron Man?
Yeah.
That's got to be a copyright.
So Intel's happening, like, literally live as we're speaking.
Is he wearing it in that photo?
Yeah.
Can we zoom in on that photo?
So this is like a classic... Intel move, by the way. Like, you know, Intel doesn't sell anything.
Get closer.
Enhance. Actually, enhance on the RoboCop, because that's cool, too.
Intel has introduced a robotic cop that is going to police the streets of New Detroit. It's
going on?
That would be amazing. Now look, it's
happening here. There's like a weird wave. It's like my hair wants to go surfing.
Yeah.
Anyhow, go on.
I was saying.
So Jarvis has been announced.
This is like a classic Intel
breaking news. Exclusive. Intel.
Let me just read this list.
My chair is.
This
like,
is crazy. Just now, I mean,
I feel like I'm going to just slide back into this TV.
Go, do it.
It's like somebody's oiled the wheels of this.
Really? I wonder who that could have been.
Earlier tonight, we had a chance to sit down.
Let me just read these headlines to you.
Go on.
Intel unveils Jarvis smart headset. Intel debuts prototype smartwatch. Intel partners with Barney's and other fashion leaders on smart wristwear.
Hey, you know what's
Intel in? Intel introduces Edison, a computer the size of an SD card.
What? Hey, you know what's in? Smart stuff.
I think Intel's whole thing is they're trying to prove that they can make tiny, powerful. They introduced this processor called Quark, which is like a tiny little processor.
I think it's adorable. I think Beanbird runs on that.
Bird Bean? We should talk about LG.
We should talk about something other than 4K.
We should.
Because we talked this topic. No, I mean, we just keep having the same conversation. I'm like, it's going to be a while. And you're like, I think it's going to happen sooner than you think. And then, like, we just talk about that for 25 minutes.
Well, yeah.
Here's what I will say. To your very cogent point, I think sports ball, will move the needle for a lot of people.
Yeah.
I agree. Just not for this person. Just not for this people.
I will say that yesterday I watched the Rose Bowl in high dynamic range 4K.
Did you start crying?
It was incredible. But at one point I was
just
like...
Just the Dolby Vision?
The Dolby Vision, which is... Yeah. I mean, you should go look at it because it is incredible. But at one point I thought, and the screen was 120-inch Vizio screen. And at one point I thought to myself, wow, this is beautiful. I'm pretty sure I can see through those players' pants because they're wearing white pants and that's not something you think about. But I was like, we're going to have to rethink all of this.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's like that Sony. Remember that Sony camcorder that came out with night vision?
Yeah.
That was like strong enough that it actually could like see through some light colored clothing.
Yeah. Vlad's like, yes.
I actually had several versions of that camera.
They do actually have fragmentation in the NFL as well in terms of
Fox 720. Oh, in the uniform design?
Yeah. So some of them, like the Steelers, they have those yellow pants and they're more.
Yellow pants.
The yellow pants. They're less revealing.
The fear.
Well, it's just like a weird thing to be watching on television and to like think that. Like,
yeah.
Okay, so here's the deal with Intel. This is all happening right now.
It's all happening. By the way, we have a live. I think we're streaming the video of the event.
Well, no, because we're.
Well, no. Oh, that's right. We're on. Oops. Okay. You know, it's been a long day.
Well, we just lost the control.
We've been a long day.
No, so
what's happening?
Intel introduced a tiny little chip called Quark.
Ross, I got to tell you, my drink's almost empty.
Quark isn't brand new, actually. Are they rehashing it?
Well, it's the name, probably. It's a fifth the size of Atom, uses a tenth of the power. The Quark X1000 was introduced at IDF. I get it.
Yeah.
So Intel had Quark at IDF. Sorry, I'm in our story stream. Things are crazy. And now they're putting in all kinds of things here at CES.
Yeah.
I got it right. I figured it out. Yeah.
But that's Intel. I mean, last CES, they had this hybrid transforming laptop thing going on.
Yeah, so Intel's always desperate to prove the things you can do with their chips. And here's the problem with them. They have better ideas than all of their manufacturing partners.
That is true.
Like, every time. Like, Intel's manufacturing partners are like, you had a good idea about a transformer. What if we added more stickers and hinges to it?
Well, I mean, yes and no. At the same time, Intel's whole two-in-one thing where they're trying to push every manufacturer to give a tablet that also converts to a laptop.
Mm-hmm.
Essentially, Intel's play to try and get into the tablet space, which ARM still dominates. You know, you got the iPad, you got Android devices.
Well, I think this thing, what's interesting here is that they lost mobile, right? I mean, they've got Bay Trail, it's cool. Nobody's putting it anywhere.
There's a Lenovo ThinkPad 8.
That's great.
That's coming.
Nobody's going to buy it. What's happening?
So what are we talking about right now?
What?
We're in the weeds, man.
No. They made a little
processor. What happened to Jarvis? A second ago, it was a wearable personal assistant named after an Iron Man robot.
Yeah.
A computer, actually. Mm-hmm. AI.
Mm-hmm.
Ross, I don't know if I mentioned this, but is there any way I can get more vodka this spring? I know you're not my waiter or anything. But did we hire a waiter?
Hold on. Intel announced their Android Windows thing, too.
What?
Intel's happening, man.
What is it? Intel is hot right now. Listen, just stop watching this, because frankly, you're not going to get anything out of it. And I mean, it's just garbage.
Watch Intel.
And go watch the Intel event.
read the live blog that we're doing, right? We got people there working hard. No one's working hard in this room.
I'm not. I'm just trying
to. I mean, look at this guy over here. He's taking a nap, basically.
Well, this is all like going down.
You'd like to take a nap, wouldn't you? Do you feel tired? Are you tired at all?
At all? I only started at like 6 a.m. with OG.
Did you hear the way you said that? Did you hear the way you said that sarcastically? I only started at 6 a.m.
Wait, so let's let Intel happen around us.
I would love
you started this morning at LG.
And
tell me,
Reed Hastings.
This is probably the biggest news of the day.
No, it's not.
It kind of is.
No.
I mean,
the biggest news of the day was Michael Bay storming off stage during Samsung's event.
I still haven't seen that.
Actually, today was like, there really weren't any great pieces of news.
Well,
except for this Jarvis situation.
No, I think, well, Michael Bay is like his own news. I think the Pebble Steel is a big, I mean,
yeah.
Our entire trailer bought a Pebble Steel.
Oh man, Grubbs dissed that. Did you see that stuff? Yeah. John Gruber did not like the Pebble Steel.
Yeah.
I mean, why?
That's cool.
He didn't like the logo on the front.
He cannot have a smartwatch for another year. That's great for him.
I don't know. Hey, when Apple does their smartwatch, they make the Pebble Steel look like a Pebble Rock.
Yeah, it'll happen.
Yeah, that didn't make any
you
sense.
Did the Toyota car.
That yeah, was cool. So that happened today, I was saying before we went on. The iRoad, I test drove this crazy three-wheeled car, which I sincerely hope you guys have watched the video of, and if you haven't, you really should. It's like a commute. Oh, also for Europe and Asia, again, they're ahead of the curve. A commuter, we've got city bikes in New York. You know what they're gonna do in Europe? You're gonna be able to car share a Toyota, like leaning the iRoad. Well, it's a bad name, but this crazy Toyota.
It's a terrible name.
But in Europe and Asia, they're going to have car sharing of the iRoad. You're gonna be able to grab this awesome leaning electric vehicle and scoot around a city. You know, we have city bikes. City bikes. They're just Citibank advertisements rolling through Times Square.
Do you think these are not going to be sponsored by anyone?
They're going to be sponsored by awesomeness. You have a drink for me? I'll take it. Things are getting real in here. Yeah. They're getting real. Thank you. You're a wonderful man. You're beautiful. Here it is. Oh, here I am.
I'm very confused about this photograph.
So apparently there's a seat in the back and you put like a baby or something?
Because what you want to do is whip around with a baby while you lean through corners.
I got kind of like a Sopranos outfit on in this episode. I'm like, am I going to go? I'm like, yeah, me and Big Pussy are going to go break somebody's kneecaps. That's his name on the show.
I'm just saying, in the world's least tough car.
Yeah. No, well, Big Pussy would not be able to get in there. I mean, you couldn't even get one of him in there.
How many wheels does it have?
They were like, by the way, Toyota was like very specifically, they're like, this can fit two Homo sapiens from Japan inside of it. And I was like, or maybe one American. What did you say? It's got three wheels.
Three wheels.
And it steers with the back wheel, and it leans into turns. And what's interesting is that the faster you're going, I'm sure there's a physics reason for this, but the faster you're going, the larger your turn radius is. So you can go really fast around turns and it won't tip. They're terrifying. It's like you're really lean, but you have to be doing a really wide turn.
Yeah.
But also you can make crazy on the dime little pivots when you're going slower. It's so much fun. Yeah. No, they said that Toyota said that I was the only journalist who actually put the pedal to the metal.
That's funny.
Yeah. So much fun.
I know Renault
did we install a GoPro in there?
Yes, we did.
That's awesome.
GoPros, by the way. GoPro like snuck up and is now, it just owns video production. Everybody uses GoPros.
Yeah.
Like you talk to anybody who's doing video and they're like, oh, yeah, just throw a GoPro in there. It's like just a thing now.
Yeah.
GoPro just took over.
Sony is desperately trying to compete.
Okay, what's going on with the Jarvis?
Where
is he performing any Pulp songs?
Things are happening at the Intel keynote. We're just having.
What's happening?
Well, so they made this tiny chip, but now they're just like putting it in all kinds of prototypes.
Are they putting it in wearables?
Because they missed phones.
Is it being put
so into Eddie, desperate being, to win wearables?
Is it being put into Eddie werewolves?
No.
How many werewolves will get the new Intel chips like today?
Werewolf powered by Quark.
Yeah. Okay. So wait.
My internet's down.
Really?
As always.
But you're on Ethernet.
Yeah.
Here you go. 4K. Really? You can't even get at the Verge. Verge CES studio, one of the most technologically advanced areas of the world.
It's kind of insane.
You can't get a consistent connection.
Oh, here we go. Let's see what else.
And you're telling me,
Dieter's
at Intel. Telling me I'm going to be able to watch Orange is the New Black in 4K in my house? You're high and drunk, my friend.
No, DreamWorks is there.
I'm just floating out here, Nilay. You give me nothing. You're reading the internet. This is literally. We're talking.
They're
we're having
printing
a Vergecast
keychain at the Intel.
I mean, Vlad is falling asleep over here.
I'm doing what I can.
You're reading a live
blog.
You
asked me what's going on, so I went and found out.
Well, I just wanted a few details.
Let's do this. Let's not read the internet. Let's export my experience of the day because
I really did.
Just like Reed Hastings, I spent the day running around. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Keynotes.
Let's talk about LG.
LG is it was interesting, but the disappointment with LG is that it basically showed us exactly what leaked with WebOS.
Right. Well, we saw the press release last night that LG Korea just put out the press release for the WebOS TV, so we knew all the details of it. And so there were no. And Dieter actually had a great behind the scenes look at the thinking behind the interface.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't a big surprise today.
Right.
Did you see anything that really got your juices flowing?
Yes.
What was it?
I mean, LG is pushing two things on the TV side, which is obviously the WebOS interface. It says that over half of 2014 TVs are going to have it.
It's a beautiful interface.
It does look like it.
For a smart TV, it is the most handsome interface that anybody has done.
Have you held the remote in your hand?
No.
Yeah.
You don't like the remote? You got a remote problem.
It's not good.
What's the deal with it?
It's shaped like a, you know, the Wii joystick. Mm-hmm. It's kind of shaped like that, but it's got a ball on it, like a trackball. Why?
And I think it uses an accelerometer or something.
Yeah. Can you do this with it, or is it like you're just wheeling the guy?
And there's a ginormous cursor that you have to poke around.
Yeah,
place.
Well, what's a better way to do it?
It's an interface. You can jump around with arrows.
I think about this every time we talk about TVs. You talk about the remote.
What is that?
That doesn't look bad.
It's not good. I've played with it.
I don't mind it.
I did a hands-on with it several. I mean, they're getting better, but that's
you pair that with the VR pivot. Is it pivot VR? Yeah, the Elysium suit, the case you wore. Anyway, go on.
Yeah. Well, okay, that's happening. WebOS TV is happening. 2014. That's good.
Cohesive interface too.
Is it?
It's cohesive.
They have like app standards. It's built
right. They have design guidelines, which I think are. I think design guidelines, when it comes to making whatever the next TV interface is what it is all about. The one thing I'll say that Apple has done the right job of, for better or worse, I don't think their interface is really very good, but they basically said, we're gonna make your Netflix app. You're not gonna code your own Netflix app. It's gonna be within our guidelines for how it should function. And that means that everything on the Apple TV works exactly the same.
Right.
But that's the thing, having guidelines and having guidelines followed are kind of two different things.
So. That's true. If you don't let people make apps.
LG is an Apple, right?
So
yes, that is very true. that's the most true thing you've ever said.
That's a little rough for them.
The other thing that LG is pushing is the 105-inch curved Ultra HD 4K TV, etc. There's no price. There's no release date.
Well, so they all have curved ones this year, and then Sony made a triangle.
By the way, it's a wedge, and
it's a triangle.
We changed that.
It looks like
I want you to know the headline was changed.
Triangularly shaped.
We had a conversation in the trailer. That headline was changed. Well, there were a lot of confused people in the trailer.
But the standout thing for me from LG.
People were like,
joke. It's a triangle.
No, I know.
Here's the thing. Everybody wants their TVs to look different. Like, everybody has flat screens now. So, like, look at this one. And, like, half of the companies are like, it's curved. And
Vlad,
like,
do you understand the curve?
The curve of the TVs?
Yeah, yes. Why? Why?
It's cinematic. Again, at that scale, it makes a difference.
At 105 inches.
And
at 70 and 60 inches as well. And at that scale as well.
Really?
It does make a difference.
It does.
The thing that LG said.
Yep. Only if you're sitting 4 feet from it.
The thing that LG said.
I'm saying
I understand the idea, but when you're 12 feet away in your living room looking at a 60-inch TV, it just looks like a misshapen television.
No, it's
I haven't seen them in
big.
Person, I should
it's
say.
It's still pretty big. But the thing that LG
from
said.
12 feet, really.
Which was pretty much a lie, was that they don't do innovation for innovation's sake. Mm-hmm. And the device that they cited to say that was the G Flex phone.
Yeah, right. The curved screen that makes zero sense.
But here's the distinction. At 6 inches, that curve is completely pointless. And, you know, they put it in landscape mode, and they said it gives you a cinematic experience when you're holding it in front of your face at 6 inches. No, it doesn't. But at 65, 70 inches, 100, if you can ever afford the space to fit that somewhere.
100-inch phone? Seems big to me.
I'm talking about the TVs now. I'm just saying the curve at that scale and at that size, it makes a difference.
Okay, I do get that, but I'm gonna buy a 100-inch television.
And a barn to fit it in.
No, but yeah, right. Okay, but let's just pretend I can afford a 100-inch television and I have room for one.
Yeah.
Is it really that dramatic of a difference between having a big-ass 100-inch television and having a big-ass 100-inch curved television?
I can't say I'm an expert at that.
What would you do if you had to choose one?
What I would do is I would get the OLED.
You would get the OLED 100-inch, not curved?
No, they don't have a 100-inch OLED. They have some 16, 17-inch.
Okay, fine, but I'm saying, but do you think the curve, if you push came to shove and you had to make a choice between a 65-inch curved and a 65-inch standard display, which would you choose?
I wouldn't pay a surplus for the curve, but I might go for that. I mean, the thing I would definitely say...
These are not the words of a person who believes in curved TV.
Right, but the thing that stood out to me, and maybe that's just because I'm a sucker for OLEDs, and this happens every year, is the curved OLED TV. And also, the more important thing, probably, is the fact that last year we had two big trends for the future of TVs, which was OLEDs actually starting to ship, big screen OLED TVs, and 4K. Whereas this year, what LG did was it combined the two. So now you're not really having to pick. It's not, do I want a 4K TV or do I want an OLED TV? If I just want to really push the boat out, I can have both.
Right.
And then the curve, at least, you know, in looking at it for a couple of minutes, it's kind of like a bonus.
The curve is just a new thing.
It's just like dressing when you're silent. Some people prefer it, some people don't.
No, I think that's wrong. I think it's like, I would say that the vast majority, 99% of people who eat salad like dressing. And you know what?
Well, I'm the other
dressing
percent.
Is necessary to lubricate the salad.
Then that's a terrible
salad.
Well,
that just happened.
That's a terrible
that's
salad.
That's right on the internet.
Have a tomato.
Just because you don't like dressing on your salads. He did say that. Just because you prefer a nightshade vegetable instead of delicious, tangy dressing.
By the way, tomatoes are gross.
I like tomatoes.
They're the worst.
I like them.
Come on.
Anyhow.
Let's be serious.
The point is, a curved TV is not dressing. A curved TV is fake bacon bits.
Well,
no, bacon bits are delicious.
Well,
I'm sorry.
But here's
Hold
the
on.
Difference.
What is a thing that you that somebody puts on a salad that you absolutely don't need at all?
But dressing.
No, wrong. Croutons. No, wrong. Croutons are delicious.
Croutons is
There are very few things that go on a salad that people think they don't need. But here's
You have to think of one, though. But something like a cilantro.
No, cilantro is the worst.
I mean, on a salad, you don't need it.
What are you doing?
It's just you're just trying to dress up your salad because you want to seem fancy.
Steaks.
That's curved TVs.
Do you know why they
cilantro?
Make, but do you know why they're here?
It's going.
What is happening?
Wow, you really whipped up the cilantro image quickly. I gotta say, very nice.
But here's the thing.
Go on.
The reason they make them is because they're the hardest things for them to make. Like Samsung and LG are in a war of like building hardware.
The reason they
announce basically the same things over and over again is because they pick the hardest things for them to make. Like they push the limits.
You think this is just LG and Samsung fighting each other for manufacturing
difficulties? Oh, without question. Yeah.
I don't know.
Here's the biggest flexible thing we can make. That's why they both made flexible phones that nobody.
I know. I think what it is we've run out of. We can't copy Apple. We can't make the stuff any bigger.
You don't make an 85-inch curved OLED because you've run out of ways to differentiate yourself from Apple.
No,
they're very
you
difficult
do it because
to make.
You do it because, hey guys, we go to the Consumer Electronics Show every year, and every year people want to have like the oh my god moment. What are we going to do? And somebody's like, oh, you know, the R&D guys were playing around with curved televisions, and they're like, yeah. That's great. 3D failed. 4K is not for another 5 to 10 years. Curved, we can sell in a year. There's no real justification for curved.
I feel like a great deal of the reason why Samsung is so invested with AMOLED displays on its smartphones and the way that it pushes brightness really high is exactly to make that great first impression when you walk into the store. And that's kind of the feel that I get with Samsung and LG, and it's exactly the thing that you were saying. We have a trade show coming up. We need to blow minds.
Right.
Right? We need to catch headlines.
Right. I mean, what are they going to do?
We need exposure.
What else would they have done? Without Curve, what would they have done this year?
Well, they might have done something more sensible.
I mean, half the major manufacturers here aren't doing Curve. It's only the two, like, massive Korean OLED conglomerates that are doing Curve.
I mean, I agree
and
that you're
doing it.
I think that is a component. There is that, like, rivalry.
No, but that rivalry drives so much more of this. They're hard to make.
I mean, do you think the Samsung is showing with a phone with a button on the back?
No, I mean, that's like, I don't understand that. But
that's curved to me. That's like, we put the button on the back. We made the screen curved.
Button on the back is not like any company in the world.
Right, I'll give you, it's an engineering feat.
Right, that's what this is about for them. It's like, we're the best engineering company in the world. Yeah, we make the best panels. Like, all, like, flexible displays.
But in the real, but out here, but out here in the real world, where we're not, part of the competing Korean companies, do you really think curved is?
No,
it's bullshit. Is what you're saying?
I think it's like making an 84-inch TV panel that kind of goes like this is the first or second step on the road to making a phone that like goes like that. Right, and that's like the actual thing that they need to accomplish.
I don't know what that. Why do we need to have a phone that wraps around your wrist?
Because that's. Do you remember
because
that?
People decided,
because
that's
people decided.
Awesome. People decided that the next that Apple's going to do a watch, and they're like, we got to be.
No, I meant like a huge display, like a thing that like goes.
I get it. But
that would be awesome.
But this is all about manufacturing. This is all about manufacturing demand where there isn't any.
No. No. Stop. I think this is about manufacturing, like full stop. Like they're learning how to make things.
I think LG and Samsung and Apple and everybody else live or die by the next new thing.
And they, but I'm saying they can't make the next. This is like the same conversation we had about 4K. Like that won't happen unless they figure out how to make the parts. And what these TVs are is them showing off to the industry that they're figuring out.
I think
how to
it's 25% they can make the part, and 75% we need to show something.
They're not selling
to keep,
it, but they're
to
not
keep people talking
no,
about.
They're
Samsung.
Not selling any.
No, but that's okay. They go like Samsung is in. It's floating
but
around. It's like they're like, Samsung has really impressive
that's
technology.
That's the same thing, right? Like we need to show off so people will talk about.
I mean,
us.
You,
like,
but you must admit there is a commerce aspect to this process. This is not pure innovation. This is not just
like,
people going like,
you know what
hey,
do?
We're going to just
in
like spark the next generation.
They have concept cars.
Yeah.
Right?
Like, yes, they have concept cars that they never make. Okay. In 10 years, they make a version, some bad version of the thing that they showed off. 10 years
but
prior.
Maybe economically for LG, it's equivalent to a concept car. You know, if you say, I'll sell you this, but I'll make it really expensive, and then obviously you're only going to buy like a dozen of them, then that's fine for them.
I mean, it's true that car companies don't justify why they make concept cars.
Right.
They just say, like, check out this awesome car we made.
Right.
And I think if that's the case, then that's great. But these guys
like,
do actually try to
year,
justify.
Like, like the $40,000 Samsung 4K TV last year was not a consumer product. Like they
well,
made it. To, like,
I agree. You
put
need
it
the
out
halo.
The
I get the halo. Like I get the whole idea of. Oh, I can't believe we're still talking about TVs. There's so much other
you
stuff.
You brought
about.
It here.
No, I'm just. You was talking about LG and WebOS.
But we can move on. But I just want to make.
This is like.
I just want to make.
Like, this will be our. This is our like eternal debate. Yeah. Is like things like 4K and curved TVs.
I tell you what, I've got a great segue.
It's so.
And we're moving right away.
We
from
have to talk about this watch. We still haven't done it.
Let me segue.
The Pebble?
Let me drop a nice segue.
Pebble's first. Hold on. Go ahead.
All right. Just very briefly, the point I was going to make is that LG and Samsung's motivation about how they want to push things is to make that big splash and to capture people's attention immediately. They're not really thinking about the long term of people using their device and then thinking, actually, this thing is really useful to me. I'm really enjoying it in my life. And then I'm going to come back to the same brand.
Right.
And then building brand loyalty that way. And this is the awesome segue. I feel like Pebble is doing exactly the opposite thing. They're
looking segueing into Pebble.
Yeah, he did it.
We're segueing into Pebble.
You know, I spoke with their CEO. And the thing that he said, and he addressed also the Sony and Samsung competition, the Sony Smartwatch 2, the Samsung Galaxy Gear. And he said, we see them adding a lot of features that we just don't want to add. And the standout quote for me was that people having to adapt to those devices, they're having to adapt to those watches, whereas what he wants to do is the watch should adapt to you and to your lifestyle and,
right.
and be useful. And you know, that kind of thinking, to me, is the right way. It's the right way to do it long term.
By the way,
I'm so excited about this. I think this looks so great.
Can I just say, like, this video is out of control good. Like, our video team is... Like, look, we do this all the time with them.
Yeah.
But, like, seeing this, I'm just like, my God, it looks so good.
Yeah.
It's so sexy.
I don't know how you can look at this and think it looks anything but awesome.
So here's a couple of things. So I'll say this.
Like, logo is, like, whatever, but I have lots of watches with logos.
I mean, my watch, I'm wearing a watch right now that has the name of the manufacturer in the middle of
that's
the dial.
That's me wearing
I mean,
that
that's,
watch, by the way.
Yeah, like,
That's normal.
Do people buy Rolexes and complain that they have the Rolex
right.
logo?
Right. I mean, well, the argument would be Pebble's not Rolex.
Yeah,
but you know, it's, for this type of watch, Pebble might as well be Rolex.
Right.
I mean, that's the fact. It's like they're
they're
top of the heat. So I'll say this: when I first saw this, it was the first time, I think, ever, that I thought that is kind of a decent looking watch, and I could see wearing that. Like I could see myself wearing that watch. And that's
I think,
a big
I think your
deal.
Reaction was even more strongly positive.
No, it was very positive. In fact, I said when we talked about headlines for this story, the headline we ended up going with was something that you know, the thing, you know,
it's a visceral reaction.
Yeah, it was like the pebble steel could change your mind about smartwatches.
Yeah.
And it's because I was like, you know what, this might be changing my mind about smartwatches. It's a really, I mean, for a what we know is a deeply functional device that actually does a lot of what it promises, mm-hmm. what a lot of these watches promise, this looks really good. I mean, it's a handsome looking watch.
It adds style to the substance of the original.
Exactly.
I'm not a big fan of metal bands, so that we have pictures of it with like other kinds of bands, and that makes it look really good. Especially
I think the metal band. I think the black on black metal band looks extremely good.
And that's actually a good point to mention. They do have a new magnetic charging connector, which is not great, but that's because of the original charging connector was molded to the shape of the original Pebble. So the situation was they changed the shape, they had to change the connector. It's still proprietary.
So you can't use your old connector if you get the new one?
No, I mean, there is no interplay between the original Pebble, which is still carrying on. It's
right.
Now it's the entry-level device at 149. The new one, worth mentioning,
is 249. I don't know who would not get the steel.
Yeah.
Save up for a couple of weeks or something, and months, and like get the steel, because it's a much nicer looking device. Yeah. And I gotta say, like, for the first time ever, I thought, like, I want to get this and wear it.
I mean, literally, our entire trailer just bought one at once. Like,
no, I know. I came in and everybody's like,
it was sold out. Yeah.
It was like, I think I just bought three because I kept trying to order it. but you know, what, it kind of looks like a Casio calculator watch.
Yeah, that's a great.
Yeah,
that
looks like a watch.
Awesome.
Yeah, that looks like a
and,
watch.
And that's the point that Erin Michikowski, the CEO, made. That classical watch faces look so much better in the new steel.
Yes.
Yeah.
And they definitely do.
No, it's true. I mean, that looks like a watch. It's
and that's me wearing three of them.
It's not. Yeah, that's very. It's very 90s of
how
you.
It's not as thick as the old one, right? It's a little thinner.
The thickness of the watch itself.
Yeah.
The watch body. Yeah. It's a little bit thinner. It's heavier. It's almost. It's actually twice as heavy with the steel chain.
Well,
good
watches.
That.
I mean, I'll say this.
Yeah,
if you put on a decent watch, I was surprised when I first started getting into watches and I started like trying on different. Like when you put on a real watch, they're heavy.
Yeah, they're
like,
made of
and
stuff.
If you're not used to wearing something on your wrist, like that's probably light as hell.
Yeah, very.
But a real watch
on, like,
with a metal
mechanical
band,
watch,
yeah,
like
they're
digital
full,
watches are light.
They're literally a sandwich of steel.
But the distinction that matters here is something like the Sony smartwatch too, which actually costs as much as the steel.
Yeah.
You put that on, and because of its design, its weight feels really bulky, and it just kind of it drags down on your wrist.
You know, Sony didn't even talk about the smartwatch, too. Like, they had it there.
They did.
They mentioned it. Wearing it.
They mentioned
they
it, but the kind
know,
of way that it
made a
really...
Fitbit Flex just copy, like, straight off, like, Samsung, the Fitbit Flex today.
Maybe they figured it out.
Like, they announced, I will say the desperate...
Just rip off.
No.
The desperate werewolf situation at the show is out of control. Like, Sony was like,
werewolves are everywhere.
We made a new app called LifeLog. It's, you know, the journal.
LifeLog looks pretty nice, actually.
But it's basically day one with a Fitbit, right? And then you look at their Fitbit thing, and it's basically the Fitbit Flex.
Yeah.
And it's like,
well, why up with an idea?
It's under glass. You can't even like look at it. Like, it's obviously not real.
Classic.
Like, it's just, they were like, we need
to. Well, LG has a, what is their LifeBand Touch or something?
LifeBand Touch.
Right, so LG has the LifeBand Touch. Sony has
the LifeBand G Flex.
No, Sony has, what's the Sony thing called?
Core. The core with the smart band.
Right, and
so the core is the little Fitbit.
Asus did not have any fitness stuff.
No
wearables.
No wearables.
No werewolves. Yeah. Who else today? Samsung?
I'm sure Samsung.
They had something.
Yeah.
We should know. I'd like to be able to say that I know, but it's been a bit of a blur.
Yeah. It's been a long day.
You know what's funny about CES? Can we get meta for a second? I mean, we covered a lot of news today.
Mm-hmm.
We had some huge stories. We had some small stories.
We haven't even talked about Valve.
We haven't talked about Valve. We covered
a
lot of events, but the amount of things we have just not covered.
Yeah.
The amount of things that we've seen, like PR form, we're like, that's not of interest to our readers. It's not of interest to us.
And nobody's really asking us about it.
Yeah. Nobody's like, hey, how come you didn't do this router or whatever?
So
it's crazy.
By the way, this Intel Dual OS thing is real and has been announced.
What is?
Intel is. They are partnering with companies to build computers that switch between Android and Windows at the push of a button.
But Asus announced that today.
But now it's like a thing. Like, it's Intel is called Dual OS, and
I don't understand. What's the benefit? You can buy it. You can, instead of getting a tablet and a Windows laptop,
you don't like Metro.
You get like a convertible.
Because you don't like tiled interface.
No, but what they're saying is like you can get the Android tablet you were going to buy in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
And when you need to like get real work done, you switch into Windows and run Office. Is it RT?
Windows 8.
Windows 8.
It's, oh, it's Intel. Like, it's a full Windows 8, like the Pro version or whatever. What do they call it?
No, there's only Windows.
It's just called Windows 8?
Yeah.
Oh, right, it's RT and 8.
Yeah.
At some point, it was Windows 8 RT and Windows 8 Pro. Right? Am I crazy? Am I high?
I think you're thinking of Windows Phone 7 Series Professional Edition.
What I'm thinking of is the Surface.
I'm going to throw the tweets. I'm gonna
Pro and the Surface
of,
RT.
The Surface Pro. No.
No, they were calling Windows RT. There was some.
You're definitely thinking of the Surface Pro and the Surface RT.
You know, it doesn't matter. RT's a non-starter. No one's using it.
You know what's weird?
It's not a real OS. It's dead in 5 years. RT's out of commission.
You're not going to get any argument in that one.
So. It's never catching on.
Right.
People don't care about it. No one's developing for it. No one's using it.
Have we seen a single RT tablet here?
No.
Well, we
it's all Surface.
Asus?
No, Asus is Windows 8.
Oh, it's Windows 8, right. RT is a dead product. They just need to accept it and everybody needs to move on. If they want to turn that into some other thing, that's a different story. But no one's using it. No, Windows, it's like Fetch. It's not going to happen.
I used the Transformer Book Duet today, mm-hmm. which is a device in question. Asus told me it's their proprietary technology, how they're doing the duo OS thing with Android and Windows. Now, Intel is saying it's our proprietary technology. It doesn't really matter whose technology it is. It works, right? You get a 3-4 second delay and then you switch right between the operating systems.
Right.
But my final impression was exactly what you said, which is if you want an Android tablet, get an Android tablet. If you want a laptop, get a laptop. You combine the two and you compromise too much because this thing is 13.3 inches, whereas Android tablets struggle to use 10 inches.
It's awful. You know what's great?
Anything over 7 with Nexus
7 is the perfect size for an Android tablet.
Yeah.
It's exactly what you want. It just fills that gap.
Yeah.
And a 10 inch Android tablet is like, why do I have all this screen?
Yeah.
What's the point? With the iPad, I feel like with the Air. I know you love it.
Oh, yeah, I really like it. But that's.
But the iPad mini to me is like the sweet spot.
Right.
The iPad Air or whatever, the 8.9 inch.
9.7.
Oh, sorry, 9.7.
Yeah.
It's like more than you need. What do you need it for?
Actually,
magazines and comic books, maybe?
Gigantic web browser windows. I mean, that's what I use it for, right?
You know what's a great web browser? My laptop.
Cool. Cool laptop in bed.
What's wrong with the laptop in bed? You've never brought the laptop into the bedroom.
I'm kind of like done.
That's great. If you need to open more than like,
but you know,
you need to deal with
the
like four tabs.
The saving grace for this product from Asus is that it's its price. Okay, so it's $599 with.
Do we have a clip of? Do we have any clips of the Asus?
Transformer book.
I know. I would just like to see the keynote because there was some strong.
Yeah, Johnny Shea was all over.
Johnny Shea was like
he's
screaming.
Yeah, I felt like the screaming prices.
I felt abused.
Yeah.
I felt like somebody was like.
It was cool because it was like a little shtick. Like there was a big pause and he would just scream $199 really loud and everyone was like, yeah.
Yeah.
It was like, why am I excited about this normal price?
It was powerful.
It's verging on rude. It's not a normal price, though. I mean,
the price points were crazy.
The range of devices that they introduced, the new Zen phones, it's like $99. We have 4-inch.
But they're not off contract, are they?
I mean, it sounded like it was off contract. They weren't saying $99 with a contract.
A $99 decent.
No, wait. I'm almost sure it's without contract because the higher end phones are like $249. It's like.
I'm not going to say it's a game changer, but the fact that Asus is touting great prices. For decent hardware, and they're like affordable, if it is off contract, that's a pretty big deal. I mean, it shows that like what Google has been trying to do with the Nexus devices is having some penetration. I think people are starting. You might want to Google that.
Nope.
You know,
I can confidently say I'm never
stock penetration.
But you know if they're
that's a whole different.
No, what would it be? It would be off contract penetration. Let's do a search for that.
But if they were actually on contract, Johnny Shea would have had no reason to do all the yelling.
Right.
It's obvious that he's coming to the U.S. and coming in force.
Right.
And the force is.
So let me ask you a question. The Padfone, do Padfone X's on AT&T? I kind of don't understand that product.
Hey, people have been, everybody in America has been asking, when is this coming to the U.S.?
Well, I just still, I mean.
Hey, when is this coming to the U.S.?
I like having my phone and my tablet be somewhere.
Do we have the sequence where they have the pop-ups from the map?
No.
No?
Let me go ahead and say no.
Nothing from you guys? You what? They're going to look. All right, we're actually going to have to wrap up at some point.
Yeah, we're done.
We're actually over our time limit. All right, what haven't we covered?
There's so much stuff.
Wait, do we just wrap up right this second? What just happened? Wow, really?
We just turned it off. We have not talked about Valve at all. Like, at all, which
steam
is insane.
Valve Steam Machines.
So the Valve press conference, as far as I can tell, was insane and weird. I saw
it was like a scene from Eyes Wide Shut.
I saw a note from Addie where she literally was like, hey, I'm here. It's really crowded. I'm just sort of on the floor. And I was like, God, I hope you're okay. And then it was like mostly hangout. It was apparently like 8 minutes long.
Yeah.
And then there was just like a kind of a party with like lots and lots of weird homebrew PCs in it.
Yeah, here's the thing that really drives me crazy about this Valve Steam Machine push. Mm-hmm. They're like, look, we have 13 partners, including Alienware. And they're literally the DIY PC that I built 3 months ago.
Yeah, but this Gigabyte
like, it's
one.
The actual case with a sticker on it or something that says like Steam Machine.
Yeah, can we go through the lowest
it's the lowest effort. Okay, I mean, that's real. That's a real thing.
That was nice, but go through the gallery.
That's the iBuyPower device. Can we open
like
the
look at this. Like this is insane. Like you can buy that right now from
so that's
you
just
can go on
that,
you
this
and
is
buy
just
that
a
case
this
like
is
right
like
now.
A mini ITX or something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's see what else we have.
And the next one is like totally dragoned out.
This is just a case.
Like what is happening here?
Keep going. That's just a PC case.
The next one's nice.
Okay, the iBuyPower one is cool. This is it. I built this. I own a Steam machine. I already have it. Exclusive. Verge exclusive. I've played the Steam machine.
Yeah.
And it's a PC.
But, you know, that particular toaster size design, that's the whole small form factor movement, which I was a big part of.
Yeah.
I mean, this is my...
You were a big part of.
Big,
you
were right
the,
I
had, was the leader of the European faction.
Okay, this is a hard drive enclosure. Like, it just is. That is a case.
That was nice.
It's got a little thing.
That's like
I don't know what this is, but it's ugly.
These are rejected Xbox
designs. Super duper ugly.
No, but I mean...
Okay, that's a case.
Go back one.
That's you can buy that on Newegg for $149 with power supply.
This is like a leftover Stormtrooper concept box.
They're like, we call it the Storm Case.
To a great extent, I really expected this exact thing to happen where
Wait, look at the last picture, the back of this one is particularly sad.
This is just like low, This is what no effort looks like. This is what phony it in looks like. This is what not a real brand does to show off hardware. This is not hardware.
But how is that a bad thing? How is that such a terrible thing?
I'll tell you how it's a terrible thing. Don't try to pass off a homebrew PC as a device, because it's not. It's a collection of components inside of a case.
But doesn't that depend on the software? Everything is a collection of components.
Yeah, but there's a difference between like I design casing, cooling, power supply, arrangement of parts. And like we have plans, we sent them off to a factory somewhere. We had a custom thing designed and produced, and it came back. Like, let's put it this way: look at the Pebble. The Pebble's not just a breadboard on your wrist.
That's a very small integrated device. Whereas what we're really talking about PCs.
I'm sorry, but if Steam Machines are,
but that's not a collection. Like any great laptop at this show is not a collection of PCs.
No, I take the point, and I totally agree with Josh. Like my anticipation of CES was every PC manufacturer is going to come here, rebrand their boxes as Steam Machines, and say we're done.
Yeah, I mean, look. Let's put it this way: there's nothing that was shown there that you can't build right now. And maybe Valve will say like that's the strength of the Steam Machine. But what it actually is totally unpalatable to a consumer.
Right.
No, most people who play games aren't like they don't want a PC in their living room. They want something that is.
They want a game console.
They want a game console. Right, but these aren't designed as game consoles.
You're also kind of missing the point, though. Most people who play games.
These are from the guys who released an OS that you couldn't even get to. You couldn't even install. Right. Basically.
But the thing is,
I'm just disappointed.
The vast majority of people on Steam are not necessarily the absolute mainstream gamers.
No, I understand
like,
they're already building. Then why even bother calling these things Steam machines? They're already building PCs. They're already doing like DIY PCs. Why not just say, hey, take your DIY PC, dual boot it, here's our Linux distro, well, install it.
Isn't the importance of the Steam machine the fact that they have a hardware base? And
no, because for people who are building their own PCs, the hardware base is the best thing they can afford.
Right. No, and but so, and what that, I'm saying that, is and there's, and, the hardware and, base is for Valve and for Steam and for the games the industry that are
moves,
available there.
So first off, it's Linux and there's no games for it. Second, it moves at a steady pace. Like, we know there's always going to be a certain motherboard, a certain CPU, a selection of RAM that is at a certain price point, that is at a price point, and that's ever decreasing for the older stuff as the new stuff moves in. It's like a very clear sliding scale. Like, there's no confusion about that. I just, what bothers me is that it's so lazy.
Yeah.
Valve could do anything they wanted to do. They have this controller they showed off, which is totally weird, totally revolutionary, a real custom piece of gaming hardware. And as a companion to that, and as a companion to this OS they claim they're building, this whole new revolution in gaming they want to make, what they deliver is, hey, we had some guy put together a DIY PC, he slapped a Valve sticker on it, and we're calling it a Steam machine. And I think that just says that this isn't, the investment in this project is minimal at best. Like, that's the way it feels to me. It feels like a side project from Valve. And also no Half-Life 3, so I don't really know
what to say. But again, even as a side project, that doesn't mean it's bad. Like, I think you kind of offended, you kind of disappointed, because Valve has set very high expectations.
SteamOS is completely bunk right now. It's not even...
Valve the company if it's ready? It's the company of Half-Life 3. It's ready when it's done.
Right.
Right? And nothing this about like, the Steam box is
this
done.
This is like, it's not even close to done, and it's ready.
Right.
I mean, SteamOS is a mess.
Yeah.
I mean, you will admit.
It's in beta.
It's not even installable.
We tried to have Evan install it, and he just was like, nope.
He tried to put together a Steam machine to their spec and install SteamOS, and Evan is the biggest nerd. And it was a total fail. Complete fail. These Steam machines are basically just rebranded iBuyPower DIY PCs, and they couldn't even put together a real press conference.
Gabe Newell came out and wrapped into a mic
for 10 minutes, and they were like, here's some ugly DIY PCs.
All right, well, I'm kind of giving up the fight here. But
you're going to get one.
Well, you aren't really invested in the fight. He has one. He's got a killer gaming rig at home. He doesn't need a Steam machine.
Yeah.
The Steam machine exists. It's called a Windows PC with a really good graphics card.
You know what actually makes me really angry is what? OS X and the game situation.
You know,
OS
10.
Okay, OS 10.
Well, I used to call it OS X too until I got broken up that happened.
Okay, I'm obviously not cool enough. I'll just keep typing
it's
instead
not cool.
of saying.
Oh
it's
my
not
god,
cool
this though. Main Gear One. What is this?
Okay, go on.
But here's the thing. Dota 2, just before CES, I developed a terrible addiction to it, terrible affliction. But playing it on the Mac, on a 27-inch iMac, is a nightmare.
Macs have always been behind the curving.
Right, but here's the thing
that's
that happens.
That's the irony of the iPhone.
Here's the thing that happens. I go into boot camp, stick Windows 7 on there, open up Steam, get Dota 2. It's beautiful.
Well, it turns out, here's the thing. It turns out that when you... when your OS has been designed from day one, when all of those games and all of the drivers and everything and all of the graphics cards have been designed to function with that OS for gaming, it turns out that like it'll actually produce really great results. I built this PC for $700. And I play, like, you know, Arkham Origins on it or whatever, and it looks ridiculous. It did not cost that much money to build, and I spent very little time, like, trying to get it to be good, and it's nuts. It's, like, my Mac could never do what it does. Even, like, a decent Mac could never do what it does. But, you know, and it's got, I have the thing I plug in, my Xbox 360 controller works on it, no weirdness. Although, like, literally every time I boot the thing up, there's, like, 67 Windows updates.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
It's out of control.
We should do a race and boot up a PS3 and a Windows, like, a gaming PC and see which one is ready to play a game first.
It would be the PS3.
I mean, that is
actually the thing. Like, big picture mode is sometimes really awesome, but most of the time it's buggy garbage. Like, I've got it hooked up in my living room to my TV, and it is not the seamless experience. When you turn on the Xbox One, or the PS4, and admittedly the PS4 needed some updates, but some major updates. But it's a pretty seamless experience. It's custom designed software. It's made to, like, the hardware is built to a certain spec. The software is designed to function perfectly on that hardware. That's what makes a console. That's what makes a consumer product.
Well, look, I'm sure Valve's vision for the Steam Box is exactly that. And
well, they're not showing. That's what I'm saying. They're not showing that. Their vision is what they're showing is like, hey, we don't really give a shit.
Yeah, we made a weird Linux distro for homebrew PCs.
Right. Like, we made Ubuntu. But it's not even as good because it doesn't. You can't install it.
I mean, and also, it's like in alpha. Like, we have to give it a little bit of.
Okay,
slide.
Fine.
Like,
but then don't.
That part's not done. I mean, Addy did have to sit on the ground.
Also, like, nobody's making games for Linux. Unfortunately, it's just not happening. And they need people to. They need people to build games for Linux for Steam machines to work.
Right.
They're not making Arkham Origins for Linux, are they?
Poor Vlad.
Well, don't all. Don't need to answer that.
I mean, have they made it for Linux?
It's okay. Vlad, look, we're gonna get you a Steam box.
They have it from. They have it from Mac.
We're gonna get the
OS nice 10. Okay. Okay, I think we got to wrap up.
Yeah, it's done.
Well, that's the Vergecast for CES Monday.
Day Monday. Yeah.
We'll be back tomorrow. Well, first off, we have it's first tomorrow morning.
Yeah, it's 9. I got it all here. 9 a.m. first. There's a lot going on tomorrow.
Hosted by myself and Ross Miller.
And then I'm interviewing Sony Electronics' new president, Mike Fasulo. I'm interviewing here at 11.
Live?
Live.
Live interview.
His first interview on camera.
With the new Sony president?
No. And literally the first time he's going to the press is with us.
How can you say no to that?
And then, obviously, it's going to be the same as today. You can hit play in the morning. Things will happen all day long. And then at 6:30 p.m., we're going to try to do this again.
Yeah, sure.
I'm going to drink more.
I'm sick and I'm losing my voice, so things could get real bad real fast tomorrow.
Tomorrow, the Vergecast will just be me alone drinking whiskey into a can.
Tomorrow, the Vergecast is just going to be just liquefied pools that used to be human beings.
I've been trying to get Thomas Stricker to say I'm too old for this shit all day long because he keeps almost saying it.
I'd prefer that he did the edited for TBS version, which is I'm getting too old for this spit.
We'll see what we can do.
I think on that
also,
note.
Also, I want Ricker on the show tomorrow.
That's okay, what I'm Ricker deciding. Challenge, public challenge to Thomas yeah. Ricker to be on the show. All right, that's the Vergecast for CES Day 1 and or 0 and or Monday. We'll be back tomorrow with a lot more, clearly, as Nilay just mentioned. And I wish you and your family the very best, even though they're going to be crushed to death by a DIY PC. 4K.